Before the city is awake, I come here to decide what I must do. It appears to me there are two different ways that I can live, and I have arrived at an age where I must choose. There is a way of my mother. It leads for me through a green world that one can know and understand, and goes back surely to the land where I was born, and back, still further back, through all the growing centuries of Japan. The other, it seems, is a way of my father. It starts from a world that is already new, as I said, and leads forward into a time that is not yet here, an unknown place somewhere ahead. The day that is coming comes swiftly, and it is filled with many things that now exist only in the minds of man. Of such a man, for instance, as my father. His name is Dr. Yukawa. He is a person who perhaps some may know. It is said that Dr. Yukawa is a man of great wisdom, and this must surely be true. To follow where he has gone by thinking, one must use a great machine. Any skillful man to break into an atom so that my father can have a look, and to open up a place so small, they must use the world's most powerful instruments.
Stand clear, pulse restarting at 16 cycles, 5 second rep rate. 32 cycles. 48 cycles, 56 cycles, 58 cycles. Clear the floor, RF coming on. RF is on.
This great machine, called a cosmotron, stands in a place not very far from New York City. My father explained to me how it works with the help of a model.
The cosmotron enables us to see what happens within the nucleus of the atom. All this does the work, so to speak, of an anvil. Out of this generator comes the hammer, a large number of protons. The hammer is turned into this magnetic circle. It is whirled faster and faster around. A radio frequency system increases the speed. The element we wish to study is inserted here, a block of carbon, perhaps. And the proton hammers hit. The nucleus of the element is shattered. The anvil's work is done. In a gas-filled cloud chamber such as this, the particles that fly off leave a trail of vapor. the way an airplane leaves a trail sometimes high in the sky. These can be photographed, and so we have a record of the event. Something to think about.
My father did not take the time to explain some very interesting details. The large number of protons he mentioned, they amount to 1,000 million. This number is delivered from the injector in 100,000th of a second. They are speeded up by a shock of 2 billion volts. That's 5 times as much energy as man has ever before been able to produce. These revolving protons are whipped up to very nearly the speed of light. They complete this circle 3 million times. That's 5 times around the Earth in this length of time. 1 second. This happens again and again, 20 times a minute. It is pictures like this, as my father told you, that give him something to think about. For that is a major activity of my father, to think. That's what he does, the way he works. He's been at it as long as I can remember. No matter how far back I go, even to my earliest days in Kyoto, where I was born. During all the years in the house where I grew up, the strongest memory of my father is always the same. A man off by himself, not to be disturbed. He had chosen his way long before my time. Even as a schoolboy at the Kyogoku Elementary School. Here already he was attracted to the work of mathematics. And by the time he came to the Kyoto Rakuhoku Upper Secondary School, he already determined to become a physicist. Kyoto University is a college of my father. He trained there in the old laboratories. Now he has brought to his college a new physics building, of which he is a director. In the fine new library, there are many books that have grown out of all the thinking that has been done by my father and his colleagues. I was born the same year the theory of the meson first went down on paper. And from that time, always more papers. No matter what else went on in our family, a new paper was sure to be on its way. About electrons, cosmic rays, and mesotrons, about nuclear transformations, and only the most difficult matters, until papers were not enough. And man came from all over the world to Japan to hear what my father was thinking. He received many invitations to return these visits. And so he had to leave Kyoto and the house where he grew up and all the familiar surroundings of his student days. He left the place of his birth, the city of Tokyo as well, where a garden marks the spot he was born. Dr. Yukawa had to leave Japan and travel out into the world. To many of all the places where his ideas had already gone, he now followed after. He was discussed by the students of the great universities, and in Princeton too, in New Jersey, in the eastern part of the United States.
How important is this meson?
Well, it's the key to the whole thing.
Who said so?
A fellow by the name of Mikawa, Japanese.
Smart
brother.
What's this thing do, meson?
Well, it holds the nucleus of the atom together. Now, for example, suppose you had a neutron here. Now look, let's look at it this way.
Here's an atom.
Nucleus, proton, neutron. What's the relationship between them? None that fits any known law of physics. But there had to be something. Yukawa figured out mathematically that the relationship required some third particle, the meson. It set up a field that holds the two of them together. According to his figures, it just had to be there.
By heavens, 2 years later, they found it.
How?
Like I said, by the heavens, in cosmic rays. A fellow by the name of Anderson got photographs of some rays 2 years later. And there they were, meson.
It was here at Princeton that my father was invited to bring along his family and stay for a year or more. To the Institute for Advanced Studies, where many scientists come from far places in order to think. Here at the Institute, the great professors can talk as well as think. This must be a help to find someone like yourself you can talk to. Because these doctors of theoretical science, men like Einstein of Germany and Yukawa of Japan, Wera of the United States, and Baba of India, they cannot discuss their work with everyone. Only a small few would understand. They have a special language, and so they can speak only to each other whenever they happen to meet. But little as any of us do understand, it is most proper, I consider, that we listen to these men. The questions they raise are most important to us all. Many years may go by before the answers will be found. But the big questions they ask, these already give the shape of how it will be for everything that lives. It was by such vigorous thinking, by asking so many earnest questions, that it happened. In 1949, my father was awarded the Nobel Prize in Physics. A prize. That was far from being the end, for Dr. Yukawa had more questions than ever left to be asked. More thinking than ever before, that must be done. Dr. Yukawa is now a professor at Columbia University, which is in New York City. He prefers the quiet of the smaller town, such as Princeton or Kyoto. But the big metropolis he finds more stimulating. This western city, for Dr. Yukawa, is like a laboratory. Here one finds the same freedom as in science, to question what is, to think what might be, and to go forward. But to follow in the way of my father, for me it's a difficult choice. How does one find the courage to be always alone? The strength of mind to think only about those things you don't understand? The patience to ask questions without end? The way of my mother, I believe, is to provide answers, such as how to bring a stop to thoughts that never end. All my mother's answers seem to say the same thing. There is a fixed way to live that has grown up from the oldest times and strives always to be well-ordered and beautiful. Whenever I wish to remember the land where I was born most clearly, I recall the dancing of my mother. Not to think, but to be. Not, it seems to me, to ask questions, but to learn the answers that have long been provided. This is the way of my mother. I had a choice to make now, because now is the time that I graduate from my high school. For all those who leave the general studies of their youth, there is a choice. Which profession to pursue? But for me, it appeared there are many choices, all mixed up. The way of my father or my mother, to try and become a theoretical scientist or a Buddhist philosopher. To choose a world not yet here, or in the distant past. The land where I was born, or this new one. To ask questions, or to learn the old answers. It was my name they called, Takaaki Yukawa. It was certainly not proper for me to take a diploma. It was clear that I was not ready, in my own mind, to graduate. I had to explain this to my professors. It was only proper, I must. But I had not the courage. It was good I did not disgrace this occasion and myself. What I needed was not courage. Something else. I found that out after the ceremony was finished.
Taki, I'd like you to meet my parents, Mr. and Mrs. Bear, Taki Yukawa.
I want you to meet my cousin. Who made one life with my mother? Not two. There was no conflict here, but a marriage, a union, not a separation.
Father and mother, Tata Yukawa, Mrs. Yukawa.
Introducing them for the first time to a schoolmate, for the first time to someone new, I saw them for the first time with the eyes of a stranger. This was Dr. and Madame Yukawa, whose life together was serene and happy. For me, who saw between them only separate ways, this was a surprise, a growing surprise. Were there two ways indeed? Or was each a part of the other? There was not much time to consider the matter. In 3 more weeks, you are returning to Japan. My father was to spend a year at the Kyoto University. Already we were sending those things we could not take by plane. And certainly, by the time we left, I had to be sure about what I wished to do. But now, could it be? There was no clear choice.
Profoundly silent as I stand in the garden of the cathedral, only faintly do I hear the voice of the choir in the distance.
In the oldest, most classic tradition, this was a poem by a nuclear physicist, my father. And my mother, who delighted in the order of the past, she took a delight as well in the newest, most modern household equipment. Ladies Messina, as he called it. To use a machine, my father once explained, one should understand its nature, whether it's a cake mixer or the great cyclotron at Columbia University, where Dr. Towns is the head of the physics department.
It may be a kitchen utensil or a mechanism so powerful a door 6 feet thick is needed for protection, but all machines are alike. A machine is built up out of mathematics, and so it can help us solve problems only of quantity, how much or how little, more or less. It cannot help us with the problems of value, of good or bad. While mathematics is surely the language of relationships, it has nothing to do with human relationships. When you leave the great magnet of the cyclotron and take back once again your watch, you come from a place where time is measured by the 10,000th part of a second to our own everyday kind of time. With the human problems of this, our own time, a machine cannot help us. To settle the difficulties that man has with himself, we must look to a different kind of wisdom. Freedom of the West to progress and expand. We need the Oriental acceptance of tradition to know the responsibility we all share as human beings. If out of these two civilizations a new synthesis can be achieved, there is a chance for growth. If not,
my father never finished. But I could see it now, even in this job of packing. All prints and a pamphlet on the latest mathematical computer both went into the same case. Between the way of my father and mother, there was no clear line of separation. The synthesis Dr. Yukawa talked about, this was the end for which they lived, both of them. My mother held to the past. For the ladies of Gramercy Park, she exhibited the tea ceremony of many centuries ago. It was proper, it was needed that she do so. While my father looked into the future, for what would be the facts of a century to come. A tea ceremony and a mathematical seminar, they made one life. On a sunny day before we left, we had a farewell picnic in the country just north of New York City. To see matters in a new way, that was one thing. But what to do about it? Well, It was my friend Tom who made me face the final decision. He gave me a gift of goodbye. Beginning, I thought I had a choice. I was wrong. To do what I must do was more difficult than any choice. It took more than courage. I had to make within myself a peculiar marriage, holding on to what was old, at the same time seeking freedom to reach into what was new. It was difficult, but this is what my father and mother had done. This too was the history of the land where I was born. This is what I, too, in my own life must do. And to make a start, it was surely best that I did not return, not yet, to Japan by the side of my parents. I had to learn the loneliness that comes with freedom. The old lessons of the country of my birth, so far away, these I had studied. There were new lessons to face in this strange world that reached out into the future. To make a start, it was best that I remain here for the year to come, by myself. And so, I could not accept this gift. We had talked, my parents and I, about this matter. Already I had the permission of my father to stay, if I was sure. The time had come. This was also the proper occasion when I could tell him why I was sure. He understood.